The High Chair, written by Sita Kulatunga. The sun was blazing down on her. Her spine ached as the hot sun drained her energy.
Now it must be well past noon, she thought.
When she was at home and used to help with this work every day, it didn't tire half so much. Now the bones had got lazy.
You are spoiled, she told herself.
She bent down to pick up another sarong, which was particularly dirty. Whose sarong could it be? She mused. Now, having lost touch with the work, she couldn't trace the clothes to their owners. Her mother, of course, would say which was Salaman Mudali's and which was Peter Appuhami's and which was Iskoli Mahathya's. To Prema, they were all the same, equally disgusting.
After all, my people have done this for generations, she thought. Washing clothes, Redi Nandas, Heni Mamas, they were called. Why Mama and Nanda? She wondered. What did it really mean?
She remembered something she had read in some book or other about the mildness of Sri Lanka's caste system. But just now, with the sun, a menacing white hot ball overhead, her clothes drenched, hands smarting from soap suds. She couldn't account for the Mama and Nanda, the uncle and aunt, mildness of it. This was Prema's first vacation from the varsity, short for university. This morning she came to the stream with the washing, against mother's repeated protests. Mother herself was too ill to do any work. Least of all to wash a mountain of dirty clothes. She had a racking cough and had a low fever for a couple of days. Prema was adamant that she'd do the washing today if it were to be done at all. She beat the dirty sarong on the stone with added vehemence and forced vigor. The repetitive beat of the cloth against the stone seemed to mock her. There's nobody to see you, our heroine. None except a few village urchins to whom it doesn't matter who washes what. Prema picked up another dirty bedsheet. Nausea and disgust welled up in her. The sun seemed to beat down with greater ruthlessness, making her dizzy head swim with exhaustion. Every pore of her body seemed to burn and break in sweat. She sat down for a moment, trying to gulp down the disgust. She might as well have stayed at home and let her father do the whole thing. Prema felt that she led a dual life. Just at this moment, the undergraduate was alien. The campus, the halls of residence, walks, passages, libraries, and even the very waters of those streams at Peradeniya were a far cry from the reality of the dobi bundle. Even the sun itself, above and reflected below in its shimmering harshness at her red feet, was different.
Ritinanda's daughter, yes, the laundrywoman's daughter too had passed her university entrance. Or perhaps they would have referred to her as Radhakil. She knew that the really great didn't bother about respect from others. Didn't matter to Einstein whether one offered him a seat or not. Or did it matter to Leonardo da Vinci if he were born out of wedlock. Or closer home to the Minister of State or the renowned physician. How little did caste matter. There were so many who, with the backing of money or education, had broken the bonds of caste and migrated to the town many a generation back. Yet I'm not one of them, she thought. If I could do something great, achieve something, hit the headlines, with what?
She wondered not with a paltry degree with no prospect of employment, something really great so that people would look up to her. Yet she knew in a remote corner of her mind that even this much was something. But would it suffice to lift her out of the mire of servility?
What rubbish!
She chided herself. The soap and water-worn hands, the chafed nails of her father, the sinewy, work-roughened hands of her mother, hunched by carrying the dobi bundle day after day, were the reality. Worse than all this was the inescapable air of servility, of which the bent back was a symbol.
Dignity of labor, Prema thought. In the first place, your name Prema was not your name. It was Perensina. What on earth did it mean?
She wondered. Even at the loud bellowing socialist's house, her mother or father was not offered a chair. Only a low stool. Condescension, low stools. Even kindness and charity, they were all equally disgusting. Stinking like the dirt on the soiled dirty clothes. She could remember in tormenting detail how time and again she used to go to the village houses with her mother with the washed clothes to bring back yet another bundle of dirty clothes. Some of the big houses didn't have more than one stool, so she had either to stand around or sit on a little kitchen stool. Often she didn't sit. She hung around her mother, staring at the furniture that seemed so grand. In the village school, if she wore anything new, the girls always thought it belonged to somebody else. That it was one of the frocks given to wash. They thought dopey children always wore other people's clothes. True, sometimes their people did wear other people's clothes, but she herself never did, even as a child, however threadbare her own clothes were. Prema knew what the village must have said when she passed her university entrance exam at the first sitting. It was at the same sitting that the village council chairman's son passed too. The credit of his passing, she knew, was dampened by her success in the eyes of the village. The progressive democratic society which admitted all children to the same school allowed them the same opportunities, at least as far as poverty allowed. So much better off than the American black of only the other day, she thought, trying to be very objective. But it was not gratefully that her mind hosted these shreds of thought. The thousand humiliations and subtle cruelties came crowding on her. Some of the teachers had tried to make it appear that being of the Dobie caste was the most substantial impediment to arriving at a correct answer to a sum. The primary school was way worse than the big school in that small town. As a very young child, she was not able to understand the little stubs, the not sitting next to, the not holding that girl's hand spirit of her classmates. It was only later that those could harass her, even in retrospect, the duality of it all. A lifetime of it should have hardened her and make her as tough and sturdy and thick-skinned as the kumbuk tree nearby. No. She was still as soft and vulnerable and sensitive as a rain sodden nearer by the paddy field, which heaved and sucked your fear when you walked along its grass-covered wetness with the added weight of the dobi bundle. This morning she thought of all this as she had the lurking fear that she would have to take a few washclothes to the VC chairman's house. Surely her mother was not well enough and her brother would never go anywhere with a bundle. She knew that Tilak's shirts too were there. She was certain that it was one of those shirts he was wearing when she first met him on the campus. As they hadn't gone to the same school and he had studied in Colombo, he didn't know her well. When a friend of Tilak's was about to introduce him to her and paused to ask, "By the way, are the two of you from the same village?" How she wished she were dead. She could remember herself stammering, "You from the same area?" He probably placed her only when she said, "On the other side of the village beyond the paddy fields," so that he would know at once who she was. "Beyond the tea kiosk," she continued breathlessly, to stop him asking any more questions. She could have worshipped him for his quick rejoinder. "Oh yes, I know. Our families have known each other for years, though we are strangers." How natural he made it sound. She knew that he had been sensitive enough to pick up the pleading message in her eyes. But when he continued, "Even a fortnight ago when I was home for the weekend, her mother came visiting." She felt he was teasing. It was as if the two of them were sharing a shy private joke, as if they had joined forces to deceive the others. For what would be the visit of her mother but to bring the bundle of clean, well-pressed clothes? The picture of her mother weighed down by the bundle on her head walking through the paddy fields and coconut groves fell into focus in her mind's eye. It was late when she came home.
exhausted from washing, bending her back over dirty clothes for so long. Her mother was still running a temperature and coughing, a dry, racking cough. The peculiar smell of dirty clothes assailed her nostrils as she entered that part of the little house. Now it was so much better than when she was a kid. Back then it was only a little kajan shed. Now that people had started paying in cash, they had been able to put up two rooms where they could sleep. The days when people paid in kind, a measure of rice from here and a couple of coconut from there, were coming to an end. Even so, what little did money buy now? Soap was so expensive and so was starch. And even the coconut shells to be burned in the heavy black iron meant money now. Would the damp, stale smell of dirty clothes never leave her? In the evening, she found herself on the way to Tilak's despite all her mother's protests. She had a bitter argument with her mother who insisted on going herself in spite of her fever. "Why? What's wrong with me that I can't go?" challenged Prema.
"If they must have their clothes today, I will go. It's not that you can't go, but that you educated girls shouldn't go,"
was how her mother argued. Eventually, Prema managed to send her mother back to bed before setting out on her errand. She wore the most unobtrusive skirt and blouse she could find. By then, the defiant attitude of the morning had left her. The smoldering fire of the early hours was now a dull ache. She planned to enter the VC chairman's house through the back door, leave the clothes with the servant, and vanish. Would they insist on giving the dirty clothes to her? How could she refuse if they collected the dirty clothes? 5 shirts, 4 saris, 6 pillowcases, so many pairs of trousers, with the lady of the house taking them down in an old exercise book while the dobi counted them out aloud. Perhaps some of them will be Thilak's. She felt her legs shiver and a cramping hot shaft of pain in her abdomen. Was it fear, shame, or what? How could she achieve anything great if this little ordeal loomed before her in such massive proportions? As she entered the Jaisuri compound, her legs seemed to falter. As if in a daze, she rushed through the gate with a bundle which was wrapped not in a cloth but in a goddamn newspaper, still warm in their newly pressed cleanliness. When she entered the kitchen quarters, Lucy Hami, the servant, looked surprised. Yet she knew who was who, rose to the occasion, and took her to some sort of storeroom come second dining room. There was a table surrounded by a few chairs. She put the bundle on the table and stood there waiting. Lucy Hami on time found a small schoolroom chair and set it in a corner away from the high ordinary chairs. Prema stood still, waiting, debating, wondering, "Do I sit or don't I?" When she heard footsteps just beyond the curtained door, she stood rooted to the ground, praying it wouldn't be Tilak. Her heart beat against her ribs as if it were trying to break loose and burst through, and her throat was purged in a cracked, earthy dryness. "It was Tilak, just as my cursed and foul love would have it," she thought in a panic. In that one brief moment, which was an eternity, it was as if years of tainted servitude, low stools, cracked cups kept apart for the visiting dobi were one and all crowding on her, pressing on her, pressing on her brain, smothering her. Even to sit, she couldn't find the chair which was so low, so abysmally low. "Prema?" Tilak seemed to breathe out his suppressed surprise in those syllables. Ignoring the bundle on the table, he said, "Take a seat here, do sit down." As if he too was pleading, he drew out a tall high back chair from near the table. Prema came up to the table. She stood, holding the high back of the chair, running her fingers over its carved edge.